Was Play the Game, written by Mercury himself. Another experimental song was Crazy Little Thing Called Love, which I'm sure we all heard is a tribute to Elvis Presley. Primarily, it's on a 12-string guitar. It's one of the few songs Mercury actually wrote on guitar that was not a singing instrument. He actually wrote the song in 6 hours on a guitar. And by the time Brian May, the guitarist, gets in the studio, the song's already pretty much done. It was just like... Speaking of May, he wrote Save Me. But the most famous song, of course, is Another One Bites Dust, written from the most unlikely of places, John Deacon. John Deacon, as I mentioned, was the band's bassist, but he primarily stayed in the background. He didn't like singing, so there's most Queen songs only as Roger, Freddie, and Brian's vocals. John rarely included in on the vocals. Another One Bites Dust, everybody thought it was going to work. Roger Taylor has gone on stating that he thought it was a waste of time. They don't do disco. He's a rock band. He sounds like a disco song. Of all people, probably Michael Jackson, who kept egging on the band to release the single. He's like, yeah, man, you should release that. It's your new single. You should try it, man. Ultimately, it was, and became the number one of both the U.S. Billboards and UK album charts. Overall, thanks to No Mites Dust, the album became 4 times platinum in the U.S. and gold in the UK. This is the highest selling studio album of the band. Which, of course, meant they're going to go on tour. They go on tour around the world, but the one I want to talk about is South America. South America was a very untapped resource for music at that time. This is in the midst of what's called the Dirty War, which essentially was a big political uprising between far left and far right. So Argentina was essentially a war zone, and they're called to go and play concerts there. When they get there, there's glass shards all upon the tarmac when they first get there, in bottles. When they are taken to the stadiums to perform, you can imagine how just chaotic it was. They randomly see police guards. At one point, there was a traffic jam. Their guard in the car stood up through the sunroof and began opening fire with a pistol. Sitting there like, regardless, the performances in South America were some of the largest to date. In the two-day event, in total, 300,000 people attended at Buenos Aires, and 120,000 to 130,000 attended at Sao Paulo. Apologize if I mispronounced that. At the time, highest ten concerts in Argentina.
Skipping forward in the video. You have to just click the
escape.
Not
no,
that.
Don't click escape. Just click my keyboard. Click my actual.
I did.
Yeah, skip to the video.
Oh.
Yeah, so you're gonna need to hit escape once, I think, and
yes,
then.
Yes, you're correct.
Yeah, and then click
there,
the yes,
there.
And then you can click full screen again.
I don't know why it doesn't want to go full screen.
Oh.
So. We're now going to their next album. They're Not One Bites the Dust, even though it was an experimental, was a surefire hit. And they decide we should implement disco more often into our albums. Now, I should point at this point, Mercury had moved to Munich, really liked it because the British press were pretty much hounding him. We're all positive that we know that he had a homosexual lifestyle, and at the time it was very taboo. So he wanted to get as far away from the press and really enjoyed the night scene in Munich. The problem is, he begins gathering a posse around him, his own friends, and probably weren't the best people to be around. So, he and his posse essentially influenced the disco drive that Hot Space is going to go toward. This is going to be the 10th studio album, by the way, for Queen. So, there begins a very big riff going on here in Munich Studios. You have May and Taylor, who are very rock, they're very rock heavy with their drums and guitars. The disco, the dance, the funk that Mercury and Deacon are more popular with really just don't involve a lot of it. So what's gonna end up happening is a riff between the band. Now one of the few bright spots out of Hot Space is of course Under Pressure, which was done with David Bowie. I'm sure we've all heard of it. It was one of our successful songs, you're gonna use it a lot. But it was actually recorded early on for the actual session before the Hot Space. This was recorded at their own personal studios at Montrose, which we'll talk about briefly at the end. So, you get this album that's very jarring. You're going to have a mix of your usual rock. It's not really anything to talk about. And then you're going to have to deal with the disco, which I should say, it's not bad. It adds pretty decent music. The album all around is pretty good. The problem is they're alien and they're targeted our audience. So when Hot Space comes out, it does do decent on both charts, as you can see, but the core Queen fans were very taken aback. They really did not like where they were going with. And this would result in the resulting tour. Chance of disco die essentially occurring during the tours, essentially. The tour itself was troubled during the entire month of April. There was constant set list changes. They didn't have a set down set list until May. So they kept going back and forth. They're going to each of the concert in separate limos, each man members. There's a very big divide going on.
So the pointer's really off.
It's not the center.
Now most of you know that we got some new sounds out in the last week and for what it's worth, we're gonna do a few songs in the funk black category, whatever you call it. That doesn't mean we've lost the rock and roll feel, okay? I mean, it's only a bloody record. People get so excited about these things. I mean,
So that was from the Milton Keynes concert in 1982. Freddie was trying to refer to all the controversy sound from the album. The album ultimately was one of the weakest installments that Queen ever put into their discography. And ultimately, over 10 years of being on the road together, they're starting to get strained with one another. They decide to break up and go on their own solo careers. So we're star John Deacon, 1983. He went and ended up working with various other artists and formed a brief band called Man Friday and Jive Jr. Here's the problem. I was trying really hard to find some research on this group. There's hardly anything out there. All I can find, they released one single in 1983 called Picking Up Sounds, very hip-hop-esque, and that was about it. Brian May went over to California and was going to hang out with one of his friends, Eddie Van Halen. They're going to have a weekend jamming session. Well, this resulted in the album, essentially. So you had Eddie Van Halen, Brian May, and several others working on this big album. It was inspired, partially lead songs, partially inspired by Star Trek Starfleet. Essentially, it's a weekend jam going completely crazy. Roger Taylor, he actually had a solo career going since 1977. He released his first solo album in 1981. And the second one released at the start of 1984 was Stranger Frontier, the song you hear now, Man on Fire, sung by Roger Taylor. There was also a lot of Bruce Springsteen, Bob Dylan covers. Right, really much talk about. You're starting to get the idea that a lot of these side projects are just meant to be that, and didn't really get much of a splash. But of course, the attention is completely focused on one man. Mercury and his solo with a solo single, I Was Born to Love You. Freddie was given a $4 million contract from CBS to produce two solo records, the first of which would be Mr. Bad Guy. Now, Mercury was very micromanaging, took part in every aspect of it, from the piano to the drums and vocals, everything. He had some input in. This was more of a passion project when it was all said and done. It was on and off work. He started in 1983, but did not complete it until 1985. Originally, it was supposed to include some duets with Michael Jackson. Freddie, in August of 83, went to Los Angeles, went to Michael Jackson's personal recording studio, started recording some stuff, and debates on who you ask. either Michael Jackson brought his pet llama or his pet chimpanzee in and tried to have Freddie respond to it. And Freddie's, you know, just kind of like, I'm friends with you, buddy, but please, I just want to record. And afterwards, I guess the situation got a little too awkward between the two of them, and he just kind of left and went back to Munich. So there were three songs we know that recorded between Mercury and Jackson. Only one has seen the light of day since then. I'll have to skip ahead. Like I said, it was released in April 1985, and it really didn't do much. It was a complete bomb. It was not expected to whatever we thought. Everybody was thinking Mercury was going to be the next Michael Jackson, like the big breakout star from a band. So essentially what happened was when it wasn't really, they were expecting, oh, it's going to be this great rock album. And here you have this nice, you can hear this song here, Mr. Bad Guy, really isn't rock. It's more of a nice pop and stuff. The album itself, again, there are a lot of good songs on it. It just was not what they expected at the time. So after they all went their separate ways in 1983, they decided, okay, we had enough of a break. We're going to get back together and we're going to produce another album. This next album will be called The Works. The Works title is named after a song. It came from Roger Taylor saying, when they were asking, what is this next album going to be like? Roger said, screw it, we're going to give them The Works.
Tap the center.
Tap up in the center.
Tap his face.
So, The Works. One thing they're going to do, Munich at the time, even though it was a good recording studio, they quickly began to realize something. It was a very depressing building. You might saw it's a concrete structure. It was in the basement of the skyrise. And essentially, they began to learn certain people were committing suicide off the building. Yeah, at the Munich. And Brian May is just like, if we knew that before, then we would never accept what in Munich. So after the debacle of the hot space, and kind of Mercury himself starting to resent the Munich night scene, they all decided, let's get far, far away from Munich, and they're going to record in sunny California. This was their first, and to my knowledge, the only Queen album recorded on U.S. soil. Consists of a variety of tracks, as you can see here, most famous of which being Radio Gaga. Radio Gaga came with the idea originally when Taylor's son said, Kaka. And Taylor's like, oh yeah, it sounds like a great idea. And it's developed into a song about the rise of music videos and the death of the radio. Which ironically led to one of their most famous music videos with inspiration from the 1927 silent film Metropolis, which I've got here. This song led them to being on one of the, led them getting back popular in the U.S. after their fall through the hot space, but it was not meant to be. Essentially what happened, their other single, I Want to Break Free, their music video, they decided to play tribute to one of the more popular soap operas in United Kingdom, which is Coronation Street. So they all dressed cross-dressed and kind of was loosely based on certain characters from the show. The problem is, while the British audiences laughed it off on this is hilarious, the U.S. audience had no idea what was going on. And again, this is early 1980s, the AIDS scare is starting, so there's a lot of homophobia going around, and you see a bunch of grown men cross-dressing and kind of figure out what's happening here. This music video was banned by MTV, which is quite ironic, considering the fact that the Bohemian Rhapsody music video is considered by many to be being the popularization of music videos. So Queen, who popularized the music video, got banned from the channel that was made expressly for music videos. This banning led to Mercury declaring that he would never tour in the United States again. And unfortunately, the Hot Space tour of 1982 was the last time Mercury was in the United States. The resulting Works tour, excluded North America, ran from August 84 to 85, staged with like the song Radio Gaga inspired by Metropolis. Mercury on a single album actually produced a song for a re-release of the Metropolis movie in 1984. It was the costliest tour to date. The light rigging was very bulky, cumbersome. The stage was too layered. You can see some stairs right back here for Mercury to walk up and around. Mercury was suffering some I was suffering from some leg problems at this point, and ultimately I ended up tripping and falling down the stairs in Hanover, Germany. He was unable to perform the rest of that night, and there were several other shows he had to miss because of it. And that leads us to Sun. Before we go to Sun City. Sun City, which was a resort located in South Africa. Now, if you guys might be familiar with Sun history, in 1948, South Africa was in the midst of what was called an apartheid rule. Essentially, what was going on, it was a racist rule, minority white ruled over the majority black population. It divided the country up into 10 segregated districts. And then you had this very nice, lovely resort in South Africa for all these people from around the world to come to. Multiple artists refused to play there. This gives you a list of some of them here. What instead had to happen was you would get blacklisted by the United Nations if you were to go to Sun City. It would seem like a no-no. Queen, though, were on the idea, and rightfully so, that we're not going to refuse to play to an audience just because that their government is whacked up, essentially. There are people there that don't want to listen to us. Their only stipulation was, are we going to play to mixed crowds? And there's going to be people of all ethnicities, and they were promised and there were. However, because that they played a stint in Sun City, they were criticized heavily by the rock community and ultimately were blacklisted by the United Nations. So coupled with the Sun City debacle, the fact that really they've only had one number one hit in 4 years, which was Under Pressure, and in early 1985, the Freddie Mercury solo album kind of bombed on the charts. It led many people to believe that this was the end of Queen. And in May 1985, they performed what they believed was going to be their last concert in Tokyo, Japan. And then, of course, this happens. Now, the reason you guys probably all came here, and probably all know Queen for. Going on at the same time while they perform in Sun City, Boomtown Rats member Bob Geldof and another musician by the name of Mitch Gurr are in the midst of organizing a concert known as Live Aid. Well, we're not there yet. This concert is going to be televised on 13 satellites to an audience of 1.5 billion. It's going to be held at both London and Philadelphia. There are going to be 18-minute sets for every artist. Everybody who is everybody is going to perform here. Now, how Queen gets involved with this is quite interesting. There are whispers of it through their keyboardist, Spike Edney, who told him, hey, Geldof's going to hold this concert. Nothing came out of it. Many other musicians really did not want to get involved in a concert on such short notice. Remember, when this was first announced, it was April. The concert occurred in July. They have schedules already. So what does Bob Geldof do? He has no people set to perform, and he has to go make a press conference. He goes to the press conference and says, lists off every single popular artist's name ever. Iron stipulation that, oh, you can back out of a charity event. How's that going to do for you? When Queen's manager Jim Beach heard a Queen was scheduled to be here, he pretty much did a spit take. And Geldof gave him that, like get back out of charity concerts. But after the multiple issues that Queen was dealing with, this is exactly what they need. A global platform to show that they are still a force to be reckoned with in the music world. Now, there are 18-minute sets per performer with no sound check. And if you're familiar with music, you don't have a sound check, you don't really know how the audience is going to sound. Like what happened earlier today with all my mishaps. I probably should have ran through it, but okay. But guess what? The Princess Bride is worth watching. It's worth not having a sound check.
We couldn't do a
sound check
because of that.
Queen, to my knowledge, are one of the few that took this to heart, and for weeks they practiced across the street from Wembley Stadium in a small venue, practicing over and over, getting their set list down to a T. Geldof wanted a global jukebox, as it were. He wanted everybody to play essentially what they're known for and get everybody excited and donate money to the to a fund to relieve the famine in Ethiopia. Many artists that day will take various ways of doing it. For instance, U2, they performed just two songs over 18 minutes. Very good set. It was just two songs. And then some other people weren't really used to the stadium-sized environment. So they were stage shy, they didn't know quite how they're going to play. And Wembley, I should note, it's not your normal this original Wembley, it was an old, soccer stadium, essentially. The sound is not like how we have today in Heinz Field. It was a giant oval, so trying to get that sound to reach out one another was very difficult. Queen, however, as we've seen, have already had the experience of being in stadiums. They know how to control the crowd. So on July 13, 1985, when they go on stage, I should point out, too, the audio was actually set at a set volume throughout the day, so it was kind of really hard to hear everybody. The Queen had one of their technical advisors actually switch the boards around and spike the audio for the performance.
Thank you.
been hailed by many to be the greatest live performance of all time. They went from six songs, Bohemian Rhapsody, Radio Gaga, Hammer of Fall, Crazy Little Thing Called Love, We Will Rock You, and We Are the Champions, all in 20 minutes. They were able to control a crowd, a home crowd, by the way, because they're in London. Far better than what many artists did in that night. And if it works at all, in my opinion, the most iconic moment is possibly this. Before the show, the band talked about the most was Led Zeppelin. We're going to reunite and perform over in Philadelphia. That performance is considered one of the worst performances of all time in rock history. Nobody was expecting Queen to put on a show like this. This gave them a sudden boost of popularity, which allowed them to go back and record a new single called One Vision, and later span into the Kind of Magic, that Kind of Magic album. So Kind of Magic was released in 1986, was never intended to be made, essentially. They were not planning to record in 1985, but because Live Aid, now they're in demand. Just to very briefly go through, Kind of Magic would double as the soundtrack for the fantasy action film Highlanders, starring Christopher Lambert, Sean Connery, and various others. Queen was used for part of their album. The album itself is not meant to be a soundtrack. It's not meant to be a soundtrack, but it was adapted into a soundtrack. So part of songs such as Kind of Magic, Prince of the Universe, and Who Wants to Live Forever were for the movie. Kind of was released just for the album. The album was not the biggest hit in the world originally, but it went on quickly to have a two times platinum in the United Kingdom, number one in UK album charts. Which allowed Queen to go on their biggest tour yet, the Magic Tour. And because of all the errors that they made, I don't have enough time to go really depth into it. The Magic Tour only had 26 concerts, UK only, yet it would be probably their most successful concert. It was probably the first concert they actually made a profit off of. All these concerts they did was their own money going into it and going out. It was the first time they ever saw a profit coming from it. They would perform in Leeds, Netherlands, London, England for the two-day Wembley event. I'm passing this around, my copy of the Wembley event. As well as one of the few rock bands at the time able to play behind the Iron Curtain. They got one showing in Budapest, Hungary. Which, if you get a chance to watch, is one of the highest quality concert films you can watch. They finished their tour off in Stevenage, England at the Nebworth Festival. And on August 9, 1985, unbeknownst to them, this would be their last performance on stage with their classic lineup. Pretty much, as I'm going to show you, the tour was almost entirely stadium-based, and if not, they got massive indoor venues.
Sure.
presentation, and I gave you, I think, a brief understanding as to why this is probably their most crucial point, and why Queen are remembered for being one of the best on stage of all time. So.